Holy Spirit be able to read them notes anyway. They're right. They're right, Bill. I'm speaking things I can't see, ear can't hear. All right, good morning.
Good morning.
2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I thought Corbin was going to preach my message when he got there. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I started this Wednesday. A lot of you wasn't here, so I'm going to go back over a lot of this. I think it's important. Paul's epistles, the last one of the last subjects Paul addresses in his section of the Bible, the 9 church epistles, one of the last things he addresses is the order of events to come. And he does this and tells you to stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have heard either by word or in our epistles. And he says, now God and the Lord Jesus Christ and God even our Father has given us everlasting, get that, everlasting consolation and good hope through what? Grace. Amen. One of the distinguishing marks of people who's been taught the grace of God is they're looking for an event that the rest of the world ain't looking for. Paul said in Titus 2:11-13, we're not looking for the Antichrist. Did he say the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us to look for the Antichrist and the man of sin and the temple and the 7 trumpets and the 7 seals? What did he tell us the grace of God teaches us to look for? The blessed hope. That is a special event for those of us that's been saved in this special dispensation of grace. That grace that saves us teaches us to look for that blessed hope. Amen. And that's why most people who've got the wrong gospel got the rapture messed up. They got you looking for the wrong things. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. It's a very plain chapter, folks. You know, I love the Bible. It's a plain book. God said all the words of my mouth are in righteousness. There's nothing froward or perverse in my lips. In other words, there's nothing that comes out of the mouth of God to get you tossed to and fro. There's nothing God says that makes you go froward, right? He said, they're all the words of my mouth in righteousness. Then he says, they are all plain to him that understandeth, right? The words of God are plain. Paul uses big words in this verse, like in this chapter, like then and when and that day. At that time, his time, uses massive words, man. You're going to need Greek and Hebrew to figure this thing out, right? But it's not difficult. And if you look here, look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I want to read, just look down at some of these verses. Look at the end of verse 2. The day of Christ is at hand, as that the day of Christ is, notice this, at hand, right? Look at verse 3. Let no man deceive you by any means. Watch this. For that day, you say it, that day, shall not come except there come a falling away, what? First. You say it? Look down at the end of verse 6. His what? Time. Look at verse 7. This one's plumb full. For the mystery of iniquity doth what? Already. That's a word meaning present. Right? It's already here. Only he who, what? Only he who now letteth what? Will let. Notice this, until. See that? There's 4 words about time in that verse. Already, now, will, until. Right? Look at verse number 8. And what? Then. So there's something already working now, but there's something now letting and will continue to let until it's time in the future when he's taken out of the way, and then shall that wicked be revealed. Yeah. Paul's telling you he's giving you all the information you need to know what's withholding the man of sin and the Antichrist. Right? All right, look down at verse, the chapter's plumb full. Look at verse 10. When the Antichrist comes, in that future time, there's something withholding. But when he does come, he comes with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Watch this. Because they received, you see that past tense. Yep. They received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send. That's future. Right. So there's a time of salvation. Men who don't receive it, there's a future time in which God is going to send them a strong delusion. All right? See how the chapter's about time? Look at verse 13. But we are bound to give thanks alway to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the what? There you go. Chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. You see, the strong delusion's coming because they received not the love of the truth. But God from the beginning chose us to salvation through sanctification and belief of the truth. Watch this. Whereunto he called you. Is that past tense? How did he call you? By our gospel. Two, here's the future for you, not strong delusion, not damnation. God said strong delusion that they should believe a lie that they all might be damned. But God, contrary, chose us from the beginning to salvation, called us by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Future. Therefore, brethren, stand fast. Look at verse 16. How long is the consolation and God hope, good hope that God has given you through grace? Everlasting. Right? Now he began this, listen, look at the contrast. In verse 2 he says that you be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled. And he closes it in verse 17 talking about everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. God does not want us being troubled and shaken in mind concerning an event that he's not appointed us to. Right. He wants us to have everlasting consolation and good hope through grace that he called. He called us to obtain the glory of Christ, not the day of the Lord. Amen. How many, after reading these verses here, I just gave you some highlights down through here. By a show of hands, how many of you believe this chapter is about time? Right? So the one of the primary subjects of 2 Thessalonians is about chronology. Right? And if so, if we have this great chapter in here in which Paul is laying out the chronological events that are to come and straightening out these Thessalonians, why is there still so much confusion as to the timing of these events? Right? Yeah. You still have pre-trib, post-trib, mid-trib. Stephen Anderson's got the post-trib, pre-wrath, right? God, I mean, just if you want to understand the rapture, if you want to understand the rapture, the body of Christ, and the timing of it, if you go to 100 churches, you'll get 100 different doctrines and interpretations of the Bible. Yeah. Right? Look at what Paul said in 2 Thessalonians verse 6. Now you what? Okay. Well, do you or don't you? Amen. I guarantee you the Catholic don't know. I guarantee you the majority of Methodists don't know. This is just real. I guarantee you the majority of Baptist preachers don't know. Majority of Baptist preachers are over here trying to teach a rapture out of Matthew 24.
Yeah, there you go.
And all of Matthew 24 is about the day of Christ, which Paul told you not to be troubled as that it's at hand. I'm going to show you Matthew 24 is all about the day of Christ. Not our gathering together, two in the bed, one taking the other left. Right? Two in the meal, one taking the other left. That's the rapture. What did he just say in the verse before? That they were eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, and knew not till the flood came and took them all away. The ones taken away are taken in judgment, not the rapture. That's why, and then he says, watch and be ready, for in an hour that you think not the Son of Man cometh. What's he talking about? He's talking about the day of the Lord, the day of Christ. The rapture's not revealed until Paul reveals it. Right? So why is it that so many people are still so confused on the timing of these events? Paul said, now you know what withholdeth. That means somewhere in the verses preceding verse 6, Paul gave you the information to know. What's withholding? If he tells you now, he says, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things, and now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. That means the information needed to know what's withholding the Antichrist is somewhere in those verses Paul just wrote to the Thessalonians. Right? Okay. Do you know or don't you? It's reality, man. So many people fail to realize that one of the main doctrines of Scripture is chronology. We've talked about that here. You realize time, the first thing mentioned in the Bible, even before God, is a statement of time. In the beginning, what? God. What does God mention first, time or himself? Do you think time's not important? Right? In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The Bible begins with a statement of time. The Bible, the first chapter is God beginning to keep record of time. Verses 3 through 5, evening and morning were what? The first day. There's time. God put the sun, the moon, and the stars up there and said, let them be for days and years and seasons. Right? So God's keeping time. And time is a major subject of the Bible, chronology. And when a man gets messed up in the Bible, he gets messed up in chronology. Right? Matthew 25 and 1, the parable of the 10 virgins. How many preachers use that to scare people to death about missing the rapture or being lost? Preachers get up and go, yeah, this church is plumb full of foolish virgins. You need to get up to this altar and make sure you're saved and get right with God and all this other stuff. What's the first statement in Matthew 25 and 1? What's the first word in Matthew 25 and 1? What's the first word? Then. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins. The kingdom of heaven is not likened unto 10 virgins till the second coming of Christ, folks. Amen. There's a time when the kingdom of heaven, Bill, is like unto a king that prepared a marriage for his son and sent out servants to bid people to come to the marriage supper. Yeah. When the second coming happens, then it's like 10 virgins. It's changing as time progresses. There's a time when the kingdom of heaven is like unto a fisherman that throw net out into a sea and gather fish of every kind, good and bad. Right? But these men, because they get their chronology messed up, they teach things falsely. Right? When you get messed up in chronology, you're going to get messed up in doctrine. Right? Let me show you. What'd you do with my marker, Corin? Did you steal it? Right here, the beginning of your Bible, Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Right? Revelation 21:1. I saw a new heaven, new earth. Right? What's in between these two events? Right? The Bible is a parenthetical, folks, of time. Right? You're living in something so insignificant. This 6,000 years we're here is just a period of time in which God is working out his eternal purpose in Christ. And I want you to understand that you, as individuals, only get a very small piece of this period known as time between these two events. But we think the 70 years we're here, man, it's just so important, isn't it? You know what the Bible says about it? What is your life? It's a vapor that appeareth for a short time and vanisheth away. Heaven and earth shall pass. Right? You know what the Bible says about Hebrews? He says, the works of thine hands waxeth old. Thou shalt fold them up, O Lord, and they shall be changed. But thou, Lord, remainest. Thou shalt endure forever. Right? In between these two periods, get Ephesians chapter 1, is what we call time. God begins recording time in Genesis 1, 3 through 5. The evening and the morning were the first day. Right? Now look at Ephesians 1, 9 and 10. Wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. You see that? What do you know about how God has abounded towards you? Right? What do you really... The only way you're going to be able to truly understand how God has abounded towards you in all wisdom and prudence is to understand what God's been doing since the beginning. Did you know God chose you to salvation since the beginning?
Amen.
Did you know that?
Yes, sir.
Did you know when he called you by the gospel in time, it was because he had chosen the salvation in the beginning? Do you know what he called you to? He called you to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Did you know Ephesians 1:4 says that he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world? Did you know that it's because that in the ages to come he's going to show you the exceeding greatness of his the exceeding greatness of his riches and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus, the exceeding riches of his grace? You see, it's all about time. And the only way you're going to understand just how truly, how much God has abounded towards you in all wisdom and prudence is not to look at your present circumstances, but to understand everything God's been doing in the process of time. Look at what he says in verse 10. Verse 9 he says, or verse 8 is where he says, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Verse 9, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to the good pleasure, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, something to that effect. Look at verse 10. That in the dispensation of what? That he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are where? In heaven and earth. Bible begins with the creation of heaven and earth. The Bible ends with a new heaven and a new earth. And in between those two periods is the dispensation of the fullness of times in which God is carrying out his will for heaven and earth and gathering it into Jesus Christ out here.
Amen.
That's time. So time must be important. Right? A study of the Bible is a study of chronology. It is a study of time. Right? And so, in order to understand the will of God, a man must understand proper chronology. Right? I mean, if you got the body of Christ going through an event that they ain't going through, do you got the will of God properly? Do you got the will of God straightened out? If you're standing up every Sunday and telling people they're going through the 70th week of Daniel when they're not. Right? And Paul said that he wanted you to know the hope of God's calling, and you're standing up every Sunday telling people they're going through the 70th week of Daniel. Are you robbing them of the hope God called them to? And you think God is happy with that? It's no big deal. Jesus Christ died to give us that hope, but it's no big deal if we rob men of it. That's a high offense against God. It's a high offense of Jesus Christ seated at his right hand. Amen? If Paul told us to look for the blessed hope, we ought to be looking for it. And people, listen, it is impossible for a man to know and understand the will of God apart from proper chronology. God is performing his will in time. Right? You get a piece of it. You know, you get a little piece of this time down here. Are you going to live that time according to your own will and purpose? Or are you going to mold your will, the time that God gives you? Are you going to use that piece of time that you receive in order to fulfill the will of God and walk according to his will? Paul said that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, increasing in the knowledge of God. Chronology is important. Amen. And Paul is writing these things here in 2 Thessalonians to give them knowledge of correct chronological events for the purpose of them not being shaken or troubled or being deceived, but that they would stand fast and hold the traditions and have everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. Amen? Verse 1, 2 Thessalonians 2, 1. We beseech you, brethren, by the what? And are gathering together unto him. So, okay, so Paul's beseeching them by the coming of our Lord and are gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word nor by letter as from us. Three things. A spirit, right? You have to understand when you listen to people preach, there's spirits at work. It might be a good one. It might be a bad one. John said, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they be of God. For many false prophets are gone out into the world. Do you have the ability to discern which spirits are of God and which are not? Because the world don't. All right? Don't be deceived by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us. That's counterfeit scripture. Right? I mean, you pick up these counterfeit Bibles, I guarantee you they're going to attack the rapture somewhere. Amen? Listen, if you've got a Bible that's proclaiming to be something it's not, that's counterfeit scripture. These people were writing counterfeit scripture trying to tell these Thessalonians that the day of Christ was at hand. And Paul tells them what he's doing here, he's pleading with them by the coming of the Lord and are gathering together unto him, not be soon shaken in mind or be troubled as that the day of Christ is at hand. That must be two events. Amen? If he's pleading by one event to not be soon shaken as that another event is at hand, is that two events? Absolutely. So the coming of our Lord and our gathering together unto him is not the day of Christ. Amen? I've heard so many people say that the day of Christ is the rapture. How many of y'all have heard that? And because of that, if you make the day of Christ the rapture, people come over there and they say, they look at verse 3. If the day of Christ is the rapture, what has to happen first? The man of sin has to be revealed, right? So how many times you heard preachers say, the rapture ain't going to happen until the Antichrist is revealed? I've heard it. What's their flaw? What's their fault? Is it not chronology? Is it not getting an event in the future mixed up? Paul lays out two events there. There's two separate events. Our gathering to the Lord and the day of Christ. And he's using this event to plead with them as to not think that that event is at hand. And then in verse 3 and 4, he says this. Let no man deceive you how? By any means. I mean, if you don't, you know, how many people read 2 Thessalonians? I guarantee you there's more people on YouTube right now searching for the mark of the beast than there will be people who read 2 Thessalonians this year. Guaranteed. And they're going to go on YouTube and there's going to be some man on there like, the seventh seal. Corbin was reading me something from Twitter the other day. The seventh seal was opened in 2005. You know. The third trumpet just sounded. Look at this river turning red in Russia. These vaccines, do you know COVID is 666? Did you know that? The vaccines are the mark of the beast. And got the whole world, man. These people get 3 million views, 4.5 million views. What did Paul say? Let no man deceive you how? By what? Any means. And then there's a colon there. He's going to give you the information to keep you from getting deceived. You need to know two simple things. The day of Christ cannot come except there come a falling away first and the man of sin be revealed. I don't care how many rivers turn red. I don't care how many wars and rumors of wars you hear of. I don't care about any of that stuff. The day of Christ cannot come until there's a falling away first and the man of sin is revealed. How's the man of sin revealed? Look in verse 4. He is God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Is there a temple of God in Jerusalem? Then what are we talking about? Revelation 11:1, when John gets that little book that Christ opened, remember the seven sealed book? He opens it and he sends it by an angel to John. John sees that book open in that angel's hand and a voice says, go take that book. John went and took that book. He ate that book, right? And that angel says, thou must prophesy again before many nations, people, kindreds and tongues. The very next chapter, the very next verse begins. And there was given unto me a reed. And what does he measure? The temple of God. There you go. Folks, you're not, I mean, the book of Revelation revolves, all of end time prophecy revolves around Jerusalem and the temple and the man of sin. And you've got people convincing other people that the day of Christ is at hand and there's not even a temple in Jerusalem. Somebody's messed up. But it ain't us. I can promise you that. Amen? The falling away and the man of sin has to first be revealed. If you understand that simple fact, no one will ever be able to deceive you concerning the day of Christ.
Amen.
Right? So you got, here's what Paul's saying. There's two events coming. There's a gathering to the Lord, the coming of our Lord. We beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord and by our gathering together unto him. That meeting takes place in the clouds, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Amen? All right, and he says, I beseech you by this, to not be soon shaken in mind or be troubled, as that the day of Christ is at hand. For that day, not this one, that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, right? And the man of sin be revealed. That happens in the middle point of the 70th week of Daniel. Right there in the midst of that week. That day can't come until this happens first. You got that? So what Paul's doing, he gave you two major events and then showed you that these two major events are separated by two sub-events.
Yes, sir.
Okay? This is what he's doing. Now you know what withholdeth, okay? What's withholding? If you understand what I just laid out, Paul says, now you know what withholdeth, that he, the man of sin, might be revealed in his time. Well, just look at the timeline. What's withholding this? What must have to happen? What has to happen first according to our timeline? What's withholding the Antichrist? The rapture. The coming of our Lord and our gathering together unto him. Okay? Show you some of this stuff. The way the Antichrist is going to be revealed is by sitting in the temple of God. Matthew 24. It's where Stephen Anderson gets messed up. You say, why? Because he thinks that the rapture is in Matthew 24 and it says immediately after the tribulation of those days. Right? There ain't nothing in Matthew 24 about the rapture. Say, so how do you know? Because I understand Paul said, I show you a mystery. Well, if Jesus Christ had talked about the rapture in Matthew 24, how's Paul showing us a mystery all these years later, some 20, 30 years later?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Matthew 24. What did Christ mention here? Look back in verse 24 and 2. Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. He's talking about the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple. That was a part of the 70 weeks of Daniel. After 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself, colon. Then what's he say? And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Right? That's going to happen after the 69 weeks. The people of the prince that shall come are going to destroy Jerusalem. What do they ask him in verse 3? When shall these things be? You see it? When? Look at verse 15. He tells them. When you see what? Why? It's the people of the prince. The people ain't coming to destroy the city till the prince comes. It ain't the Romans of AD 70. This is the people of the Antichrist. He's talking about a destruction of Jerusalem that happens in the 70th week of Daniel. And see, what I mean, I know we're talking language out there this morning. I mean, this is Bible language that, you know, most churches don't preach. But what he's saying here is there's coming a time, and after the 69th week of Daniel, Jerusalem's going to be destroyed. And they ask him, when's this going to happen? And he says, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, then let them which be in New York, let them which be in Fairmont, let them which be in Morgantown and Pittsburgh and Philadelphia, let them flee into the... Is that what he said? Who was the warning to? Judea. Let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Why? For then, right here, when he says, when you see this event, then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains, for then... I spelled that horribly, didn't I? I don't even know. I can't remember how to spell Judea. He says, but let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains, for then, this period out here, after this, then shall be great tribulation. What's he talking about? He's talking about the coming destruction of Jerusalem. He says it again in Luke, when you see Jerusalem compassed about with troops, then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Know therefore that the desolation thereof is at hand. He says, when you see these things, know that the desolation of Jerusalem is at hand. Getting it? Christ is doing nothing more than telling them prophecy. These things were written in Daniel. And he tells them, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by who? Daniel the prophet. Then a little side note to Bible believers. Not people just going through there haphazardly, getting little sermonettes for the kiddies. He says, he gives you a little side note. When you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, then he says, whoso readeth, let him understand. That's serious business, isn't it? Well, where did he tell you to go? He told you to go back here to Daniel the prophet. He says, when you see something that Daniel the prophet spoke and wrote about, right? And when you go back to the book of Daniel, you ain't got to go there. I covered all this stuff Wednesday. I ain't got time to go back over it again. When you go back to the book of Daniel, he said, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city. That is Jews and Jerusalem. You know Revelation 11, after John gets that sealed book, chapter 11 is about the holy city. The holy city, shall they tread underfoot 42 months? You know Daniel 12 is about Daniel's people. They flee into the wilderness where they have a place prepared of God to feed them 1260 days. The whole Revelation 11 and 12 is about this period of time right here. Right? It has to do with Daniel's people and the holy city. That's what it's about. But he tells Daniel that this 70 weeks is going to begin when they give the commandment to go back and to rebuild Jerusalem. And then he says 7 weeks they're going to be rebuilding it. That's 49 years. And then he says after this period, it's going to be 62 weeks or 434 years unto the Messiah the Prince. And after 62 weeks shall the Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. Right? He's given the timing up to this event right here. Now, folks, what's 70 minus 69? One. If 70 weeks have been determined upon Daniel's people and Daniel's, the holy city, Jerusalem, 69 of those have already transpired. How much time is left on the prophetic clock concerning Israel and Jerusalem after the crucifixion of Christ? 1 week. That was 1,988 years ago. Let it set in. How much time is left after? There was only 7 years left. Only 7 years left. 1 week determined upon Israel. Right? Now, every person in this world that has a problem with dispensational Bible study, the burden is on them, not me. The burden is on them to explain why God said there was only 1 week left after the crucifixion of Christ. There's only 1 week left, and when that week comes, the final week is about that man there. The whole 70th week is about the prince that shall come. Why didn't he come? Paul says, now you know. Now you know. But the world don't. They have no idea what we're talking about here this morning.
Yeah, you're right.
Listen, every person out there that likes to mock and make fun of dispensationalism and make little documentaries, you know, the dispensation of heresy and all this other stuff, where they don't address these issues, they just attack men like Scofield and Darby because Scofield had been divorced before. That's pharisaical. You attack Bible doctrine by attacking the character of the men. Satan is the accuser of the brethren, man. Do you understand that? But every person who mocks dispensational Bible study, the burden is upon them to explain why there's been 2,000 years after the 69th week of Daniel. Listen, the burden's on them. You want to mock what we say? You want to make fun of true right division and Bible study and these things? Why is there a 2,000 year gap between the 69th week of Daniel, and why has the man of sin not come? John said thousands of years ago, the Apostle John wrote, it is the last time. And as ye have heard, that Antichrist shall come. Didn't John write that? Thousands of years ago. Listen, man. I know, and then I get up here and say, 1 John's a book about the 70th week of Daniel. People are like, you're a heretic. When's the Antichrist revealed? In the last time. What has to happen first? John said it's the last time the Antichrist is coming. Now, what do you think 1 John is about? Oh, yeah, we know where we're at, Bill. Hey, man, I thank God for my Bible. Paul said, now you know. The burden's on them, man, because I've got the answer. I know why there's been 2,000 year gap.
Yeah.
You want to see what Peter has to say about it? Y'all, I mean, men love Peter. Let's go see what Peter has to say about it. Look at 2 Peter chapter 3. Let's go see what Peter has to say about this coming day of the Lord and why it hasn't happened. You want to see what Peter has to say? Will you trust Peter to tell you? You may not trust me. Let's let Peter tell us, right? Look at 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. Another, what are they doubting? They're saying, where's the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continued as they were since the beginning of the creation. They're saying, where is the promise of this up here? This is what they're talking about. I'm going to show you. Where's the promise of his coming? Peter says the Lord is not slack, but is long-suffering to usward. He's saying the reason he hasn't come yet is because of his long-suffering. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. He's saying, make no mistake about it. Yes, he's being long-suffering, wanting all men to be saved, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. And he tells them to be looking for it. Verse 12, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God. And then he says, we look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. But look at verse 15. And account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. You ever heard those people? They've been saying this stuff for years.
Yeah.
You know, I've heard Jesus was coming my whole life, you know. That's a bad attitude. Paul tells you how to properly think about it. Or Peter tells you how to properly think about it. He said every day he don't come, account that it's his long suffering.
Yeah.
Right? And understanding that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. Every day that I wake up, Gary, and I'm still here, it's a day of salvation for the world.
Yeah, right.
God has extended, think about this, God has, if you want to understand the character of God, He's extended a day of salvation for up to 2,000 years now. When His wrath comes, it's over in a short period of time. Just boom. And it's done. Account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother who? Also according to the wisdom given unto who? Hath written unto you, as also in all his what? Speaking in them of what? These things. You want to understand the gap. You want to understand the period of time that after the crucifixion of Christ and before the coming of this last time, this 70th week of Daniel, Peter's saying, do you want to understand this period of God's long suffering? It's in Paul's epistles. It's what he said. Don't take my word for it. Look at what he says next. In which are some things hard to be what? Peter struggled with Romans through Philemon also. Peter struggled with it. It wasn't Peter's ministry. The wisdom was given to Paul. And he's explaining to these Jews, Peter had been telling these Jews, the Lord's coming. Remember what he said in chapter 3? He said, repent and he shall send Jesus Christ to you, whom the heavens must receive until the times of restitution. He's been preaching that the Lord's coming. He writes the second epistle to explain why he's not. He said, if you want to understand it more, get in Paul's epistles. Yeah. Amen? So what does this mean? Well, Paul said in Colossians 1, that he had received the dispensation of God to fulfill the word of God. Meaning, without Paul's letters, Romans, remember how God is working? He's working in the dispensation of the fullness of times. He gave Daniel a big period of time back here, taking them up to the cross and a future 7-year period determined upon Israel. What did he not give Daniel? He didn't give Daniel Romans through Philemon, I promise you that. If God dispensed to Paul a mystery hid from ages and from generations, is that time? And if he gave it to Paul and Paul received this to fulfill the word of God, it means without Romans through Philemon, you didn't have the fullness of times. It's that simple. So you have to come in here now and put Paul's epistles between the 69th and the 70th week of Daniel. Amen. God is doing something here. It was something he always planned to do. He just never told anybody about it. And when Christ went back to heaven, he dispensed to this man Paul this mystery right here. You see this event up here, the second coming? Peter said, whom heaven must receive, Christ went back to heaven, and he must stay in heaven until the time of restitution up here. Spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. That event has been spoken since the world began. Behold, I show you a mystery. Not all shall sleep, but all shall be changed. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. Can an event spoken since the world began be the same as a mystery Paul's revealing in 1 Corinthians 15? Listen, let me tell you something. A man who don't understand between a difference between something spoken since the world began and something kept secret since the world began is an insincere, dishonest reprobate. If he don't understand the difference between a secret and something spoken, how's he ever going to understand the difference between our gathering and the day of Christ? How's he ever going to understand the difference between the law and grace, the letter and the spirit, life and death? How's he ever going to understand? You take a man who's like, yeah, Peter said this was spoken. Paul said he's preaching something kept secret since the world began. Oh, now what that means is, okay, here we go. You're dealing with a reprobate, folks. That's the reality of it. The only way you're going to be able to understand this is to understand that Paul received the dispensation of a mystery.
Amen.
And the 70th week leading up to the second coming, this 70th week up here cannot be fulfilled until the time we live in is finished. This period of time here was kept secret. It was then revealed. This time up here will not be finished until what God is doing in this time is over. You got it? The 70th week cannot transpire until the mystery dispensation is complete. Do you know the last event in our dispensation? The coming of our Lord and our gathering together unto Him. That's what Paul told you to look for. Looking for that blessed hope. He wouldn't tell you to look for it if it wasn't what was going to end our dispensation. He'd be telling you to look for this. The only time Paul mentioned that man was to straighten him out that it wasn't here, that there's something withholding. Are you to be looking for something that's being withheld by God until something else is done? Amen. I'm getting ready to finish up here. Look in 1 Thessalonians 5:9. 1 Thessalonians 5:9. You know what this message will do for you? Honest to goodness, man. I know some people might not think this is important what we're doing here. There was a man named Stephen Anderson who got a little bit of money and made a video called Immediately After the Tribulation, made a documentary, put it on YouTube. And that one documentary split Baptist church after Baptist church in America. Split them right down the middle. Right? People were like, you lied to us. The pre-trib rapture is not a real thing. But the problem was not really Stephen Anderson. The problem was the men in the pulpit. We straightened it up, Bill, here in about 45 minutes, didn't we? Right? Matthew 24. Stephen Anderson took a title from Matthew 24. Matthew 24 is about this. Not this. That event is nowhere in Matthew 24. That event is nowhere in Psalms. That event is nowhere in Song of Solomon, Genesis, Exodus, Deuteronomy, Mount. It's nowhere there. That event is in Romans through Philemon because it was something God kept secret.
Amen.
Right? So, 1 Thessalonians 5:9, Paul tells us, Corden was talking about the helmet of salvation. Paul tells us to take the helmet of salvation. Why? For God hath not what? But to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul doesn't want them shaken where? In mind. What's a helmet protect? The mind. Well, what protects you from being concerned about these things up here? Knowing that God has appointed you to a different day.
Yes, sir.
Appointment. When we talk about having an appointment, aren't we talking about time? God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation. Right? So we got a different appointment than the world.
Amen.
Right? Mm-hmm. You know what the Bible says about the day of the Lord? Zephaniah 1, 14 and 15, that day is a day of wrath. And if God has not appointed us to wrath, what does that mean? The day of the Lord has nothing for us. It's not something appointed to us. If God's not appointed us to wrath and the day of the Lord is a day of wrath, God hasn't appointed us to the day of the Lord. So the next time you read Revelation 3:3 and Christ said, if thou will not watch, I will come on thee as a thief. No, he's talking to somebody. It's just not the body of Christ. Because the day of the Lord cometh as a thief in the night. But Paul told you to take the helmet, for a helmet, the hope of salvation, because God's appointed you to salvation. He chose you from the beginning to salvation, called you by the gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stand fast, Bill, in the tradition, man. I love it. You know, here's one for you. Here's one. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. The day of Christ is not at hand. How can they be the same? Revelation 13:12, the day is at hand. Let no man deceive you, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Well, if a day is at hand and there's a day not at hand, I know they're not the same day. Well, what's the day at hand in Revelation 13:12? 13:11 said, knowing the time that now is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. What day is at hand? The day of our salvation. Yeah. This is a day of wrath.
Amen.
Jesus goes back up to heaven here, Bill. Acts chapter 1. Those men are sitting there looking. They get rebuked, don't they? Why stand ye gazing into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken from you shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go. What coming you think they're talking about? This one. He left the Mount of Olives, went up, he's going to come back, and his feet are going to stand upon the Mount of Olives. That's the second coming. They were told not to be looking in heaven. Paul said, we look for the Savior from where? Heaven. We're looking for the blessed hope. Somebody's told not to look. Somebody's told to be looking.
Yeah.
Why? They're two separate events. They're two separate events. When did he tell them to look up? Luke 21. When you see all these things, then look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. Paul told us to be looking for the blessed hope. He didn't tell us anything that's going to come first. He just said the grace of God that saves you teaches you how to live in this present world and to be looking for the blessed hope.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Look at Isaiah, and I'm done, I promise. Isaiah chapter, I want to show you this. What is the falling away? Isaiah chapter 1. When Paul's writing about the 70th week, he says there must come a falling away first and the man of sin be revealed, right? Now in Daniel's 70 week prophecy, when that prince comes, there's two things mentioned there. He mentions the midst of the week. That's when he sets up the abomination. And then he talks about the covenant. There's your falling away right there, folks, the covenant. He says he shall confirm the covenant. Does he say peace treaty? Does he say peace treaty, folks? Come on. What's he say? The covenant. You think Daniel understood what that meant? I know what the covenant is in that Bible. This man is going to show up. He's going to give Israel some land. Amen. He's going to allow them to rebuild their temple. And he's going to allow them to start offering animal sacrifices. You say, how do you know? Because in the midst of the week, he causes those to cease. Right? So what's the covenant? It's the law. Amen? This will help you understand why the book of Hebrews is in your Bible and why it's so important to Israel. Look in Isaiah chapter 1. Verse 11, to what purpose is the multitude of your what? God told them in 800 B.C. to stop it. Look, you don't believe it? Look in verse 13. Bring no more vain what? Your appointed feet. God's done with it in 800 B.C. Right? He's done. He said, I delight not. Look in verse 11. I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of he-goats. You believe that? Look in Isaiah 66. I'll show you what God thinks about all this mess John Hagee and Am's doing. You know, taking up money to help Israel go back home and build their temple. What a bunch of criminals. They're criminals. Say, what laws are they breaking? They're breaking the very words of Almighty God. You rebuild an earthly temple and start offering God blood, you're denying that Jesus Christ entered into the true tabernacle by his own blood and attained eternal redemption. By one sacrifice, Bill, he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. Look at Isaiah 66. Thus saith the Lord, verse 1, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you build unto me? 66th chapter. You know what book of the Bible that coincides with? The 66th book is Revelation. Where is the place of my rest? For all those things hath mine hand made, and all those things hath been, saith the Lord. But to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, trembleth at my word. God is not looking for a rebuilt temple in Jerusalem. He's looking for a man that's broken and contrite, trembles at his word.
Amen.
Amen?
Yeah.
Stephen quotes that verse in Acts 7 and said, Solomon built him a house. Howbeit the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands. Look what he says. He that killeth an ox is as if he what? You understand that crucifying the Son of God afresh in Hebrews 6 now? Amen? You understand it now? Offering, God says to offer me an ox, to kill an ox and offer it to me is the same offense as murder. That's what he just said. He that sacrificeth a lamb as if he cut off a dog's neck. He that offereth an oblation as if he offered swine's blood. He that burneth incense as if he blessed an idol. Yea, they have chosen their own ways, and their soul delighteth in their abominations. I also will choose their what? Delusions. Didn't Paul say God shall send them strong delusion? Why? They receive not the love of the truth. Hebrews 10 says, if we sin willfully after we've received the knowledge of what? The truth. Look at what he says. Because when I called, none did answer. When I spake, they did not hear. But they did evil before mine eyes and chose that in which I what? Delighted not. What did he say he didn't delight in Isaiah 1? The blood of bullocks, the blood of goats, and the blood of lambs. Hebrews 10 says, in burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou hast had no pleasure. Mm-hmm. He says, but a body hast thou prepared me. Lo, in the volume of the book it is written of me to do thy will, O God, by the which will. Amen. By the which will. He taketh away the first that he may establish the second, by the which will we are sanctified by the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all.
Amen.
That is the falling away. The falling away is the confirming of this covenant. Christ went up there to establish a new covenant for the nation of Israel. And if they fall away, after they receive the knowledge of the truth, once they're enlightened and receive the knowledge of the truth, once they come to all this stuff and then fall away, what is Hebrews telling them? He's comparing Christ to angels. Angels gave the law. He compares Christ to Moses. Moses was the mediator of that covenant. He compares Christ to Aaron. Aaron was the priest of that covenant.
Yeah.
He compares the earthly tabernacle and the heavenly tabernacle. He compares the new and the old covenant. He compares the blood of Christ to the blood of bulls and goats.
Amen.
And then tells them, the just shall live by faith. But he that draweth back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him.
Yeah.
There it is. And so he tells them in chapter 12 to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. You know what the book of Hebrews is about? The book of Hebrews is not written to save people. It's written to a nation. A nation that God had spoken to in time past by the fathers and in these last days spoken to by his Son. That Son went into heaven to establish a new covenant with that nation. And before that time comes, they're going to go through this final week determined upon them all the way back in Daniel, in which God is going to try their faith and purge out from among them the heathen and the rebels. And the ones who fall away in that period are not going into the kingdom. The promise of entering into his rest is out here. That's the rest. When Christ comes like Joshua and leads Israel into that land of promise. That's the rest. But many of them are going to come short of that. What I want you to understand, folks, is Paul told you that all of those events, the falling away, the 70th, the man of sin, all those things are being withheld. By what? Verse 7. Only he who now letteth will let till he be taken out of the way. Yeah. Something's letting, something's holding back, something's hindering, and he's going to continue to do so until he be taken out of the way. Amen. There's two mysteries working right now, iniquity and godliness. Mm-hmm. Both of them are at work. The mystery of iniquity doth already work. It's at work right now. There's another mystery at work called the mystery of godliness. The word of God worketh effectually in you also that believe. The mystery of iniquity is the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. The mystery of godliness is the spirit that now worketh in the body of Christ. The last event in the mystery of godliness, 1 Timothy 3:16, is received up into glory. When the mystery of godliness, which is the church of the living God, is received up into glory, that mystery is complete. When the body of Christ is taken up out of here, we're taken out of the way, that one new man created by God, then shall that wicked be revealed, but not before then. Amen. Hope you understand that. Keep your eyes on the rapture, folks, no matter how bad it gets. Keep your eyes on the blessed hope. The grace of God teaches us so. Amen. All right, let's pray. Father, we do thank you for another day of life. God, I just thank you for the precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, I thank you for the blessed book. Lord, I thank you for this King James Bible. Lord, the men down through the ages. Lord, great was the company of men that published thy word. Lord, I thank you for men all down through the ages, like Moses and David and Isaiah and Jeremiah and Daniel. Lord, I thank you for all of them. I thank you, God, for the Lord Jesus Christ that shed his blood on the cross. I thank you for the faithfulness of men like the Apostle Paul and the other apostles, Lord. And I just thank you for all the men that you use, God, to bring this book to us. And God, I just thank you for the Spirit of God that lives inside of me to open my eyes to see these things and understand these things, Lord. And God, I love having peace of mind concerning things that plague the religious world, Lord, as they're fighting about the timing of the rapture and water baptism and all this other stuff, Lord. I thank you. That just through this simply believing this book, Lord, you're perfecting me and bringing me unto glory. God, I ask that you keep me safe this week as I travel. Next week as I travel, Lord, I pray that you be with my congregation here, Lord, and just though I be absent in body, Lord, I pray that we'd be together in spirit. And God, I just ask that you keep us all safe, bring us back safely next time. I pray for Alan and his family, Lord, as they travel back. Jeremiah, Lord, as they're going to be traveling, Lord, we just pray for all of them and keep them safe and bring us all back together one day soon. We ask it in Jesus' lovely name. Amen.